what we can do to save America. It was recorded on December 15, 1975. The author is the famous political economist, author, and lecturer, Dr. Peter Beter. Dr. Beter is well known for his best-selling nonfiction book, The Conspiracy Against the Dollar, published in 1973 by George Brazil Incorporated, New York. He is also widely known as the man who opened Fort Knox in September 1974, as well as for his numerous correct advance revelations of major political and economic events based on information from his network of confidential sources. His professional background includes the practice of general law in Washington, D.C. from 1951 to 1961. In 1961, President Kennedy appointed him counsel to the United States Export-Import Bank, where he served until 1967. After leaving the Ex-Im Bank, Dr. Beter became an international legal and financial consultant, as well as one of the chief developers of private international business in the Republic of Zaire. He is a member of the Judicature Society, the Bankers Club of America, and the Royal Commonwealth Society of London. He is also listed in biographical reference works, such as Who's Who in the East, The Blue Book of London, and The 2,000 Men of Achievement. In lectures, radio and television talk shows, and cassette tapes produced by Audiobooks Incorporated, Dr. Beter has been publicly warning that powerful people behind the scenes have disastrous plans for America. But he never stops there. He says that these plans can be stopped and America saved. In this audiobook, he explains how. Should you wish to contact Dr. Beter, he may be reached at 1629 K, the letter K, Street, Northwest, Washington, D.C., 20006.
Part 1. The time has come. My friends, the message I am about to offer you may be the most important of my life, and your response to the challenge I am about to lay before you could easily be the most important decision you will ever make. Because the time has come, my friends, for us, you and I, the people of the United States of America, to come to the rescue of our great free republic. No one is going to do it for us. It's up to us. But I am truly convinced that we can do it. Over the past few months, more and more Americans have begun finally to stir from their slumber as they see too many things adding up the wrong way. More and more people are beginning to recognize that something is drastically wrong. And at last, there is a small but growing group of aware citizens who no longer have to ask what is going on, but instead are now seriously asking the most important question of all, what can I do? Answering that question is the purpose of this tape, and I pray God will give me the words to do so. What I am about to do is to try to open your eyes to the vast power that you as an individual have at your command, if you will but exercise it. The framers of our beloved Constitution foresaw that the time might someday come when the attempt would be made to destroy our freedoms. Therefore, by means of guarantees written into the Constitution, they provided each one of us with an arsenal of weapons with which to protect ourselves and rescue our republic if the need arose. That need, my friends, is upon us now. Our forefathers showed astonishing vision in foreseeing such a perilous situation and given us the tools to deal with it. We need exercise only a tiny fraction of their vision to see the threats staring us in the face, and we need only pick up the weapons they gave us to meet that threat. You have probably heard the phrase freedom of speech so many times as an American citizen that you take that freedom for granted. Please don't. It means you are free to pass the word about the truth, and that can make you vastly more influential than you may even have imagined. A little later, I'll say more about this in concrete terms that you may find truly amazing. You, yes you, can be a powerful clear channel radio station and one that doesn't depend on electricity or money. Our freedom of association and of assembly give us the right to get together and to unite around issues that are of common interest to us all. Every one of us has his own special interests, talents, goals, and whatnot. That's what makes us individuals instead of identical, faceless machines. But at this moment, we have an overriding common interest, and that is to save the free republic, which allows us to go on being individuals. It is crucial that we get our priorities straight and unite around this one paramount common interest instead of allowing ourselves to be divided by our narrow special interests. Keeping us divided against one another is one of the most basic techniques being used against us, and we must avoid that trap. Today, we are faced with basically the same situation that caused the American Revolution 200 years ago. Taxation without representation. Both houses of Congress today are filled with men and women who are doing the bidding of those who are trying to enslave us instead of truly representing the best interests of their constituents, you. Behind closed doors, the disarming of the American people is being mapped out by Congress. Federal land use legislation, opposed by vast numbers of citizens aware of its dangers, keeps right on coming back and getting closer to becoming law, as do measures to take our children away from us under the banner of child care. All of this is directly opposed to our best interests, yet we are being taxed and taxed to pay for it all. That, my friends, is taxation without representation. But thanks to our Constitution, we can do something about it. Every one of our senators and congressmen serves at our pleasure. We can fire them. We need not merely wait for their current terms to run out to replace them. Therefore, we can regain representation of our best interests if we will take the effort to do so. And this, my friends, we must do. We elect people to be our leaders, leading us in basic directions that we approve. But today, we have worthless jellyfish on one hand and ruthless, hypocritical, unresponsive rulers on the other. There are almost no full-fledged, honest, representative leaders left in the United States Congress today, much less in the executive branch. The time has come, therefore, not just to petition Congress, but to replace it, not with Nelson Rockefeller's appointed Congress, as he plans a year from now, but with men and women who will represent us all, as the framers of the United States Constitution intended. Yes, we have the power to do these things, and we will have that power until and unless the Rockefeller brothers succeed in replacing our Constitution with their travesty of a new Constitution. A nation's Constitution is the most fundamental law of that nation. Any other legal order that conflicts with it is null and void and of no validity. It is not a law at all. No legal principle is better established than this. In recent times, increasing numbers of decrees, orders, and regulations have been pushed off on us, which are called laws, but which are not laws because they defy the Constitution. Those who have perpetrated these non-laws and are pushing us into slavery by means of them, the Rockefeller brothers and their multitude of agents within and without the government are therefore truly modern outlaws in the most basic and ugly sense of that word. They know this very well, and therefore they live in fear of being stopped before they can get their dictatorial new constitution in place. Who are they afraid of? You, that's who. That's why they are working so feverishly to take your guns away, to abolish your right to use your property the way you want to, and to reduce you to such economic desperation that you can't think about the real source of your trouble. Yes, my friends, the Rockefellers are racing to complete their takeover and dictatorship over America, the Second Revolution, so loudly proclaimed by John D. Rockefeller III, is in reality all-out war on the American people. Until now, we have been on the defensive, trying to sound the alarm among a sleeping citizenry. But now, at last, though we still are relatively few, there are enough of us to begin our counterattack against those who would destroy our free republic, enslave us, and take our children away from our very arms. We can now fight back. The time has come. Part 2. Your personal stake in America. My friends, I trust that you are among those who, recognizing the horrendous peril confronting our nation, have asked, "What can I do?" While many of your neighbors are still nervously telling themselves it just can't happen here, you know it is happening here. The destruction from within of the greatest nation on earth, the United States of America. And so, my friends, you are now facing up to one of the most momentous decisions you may ever make, either to act or not to act, to rescue America. This is not a decision to be made lightly, because whichever way you decide, you will have to live with it. You, your family, and untold numbers of others whose fate depends on you, without their even knowing it. Furthermore, do not be deceived. This is not a decision you can avoid. Look around you at what is happening. Evaluate what you see. Listen again to my previous tapes. Decide for yourself whether I am serious about my warnings, or whether instead I am risking an international professional reputation built up over a quarter of a century for nothing at all. Use your own good common sense and decide what you really believe. Then make one of the following choices and stick with it. One choice is not to act, but to just take your chances that somehow somebody will do something, or even that the government itself will miraculously straighten itself out. This choice is the easier one in the short run, but it also has a desperate gamble in it. If you win, you will have saved yourself a little bit of effort and the discomfort of talking about things that are more controversial than last Sunday's football game. But if you lose your gamble, you lose everything, permanently. As I say these words, 13 labor camps have been reactivated all over America. They are ready for rehabilitation, so-called, of anyone who does not fit neatly into the new scheme of things under the secret new Rockefeller Constitution, once it is in place. Indeed, the entire United States will soon be turned into a huge concentration camp under the Rockefeller thumb, if their plans are successful. Preparations are quietly being made to close America's borders so that we cannot escape. You have heard of the Iron Curtain and the Bamboo Curtain. In our case, it is to be an electronic curtain the recent proposal to construct such a thing along our border with Canada, ostensibly to prevent disruption of the Olympic Games in Canada and our bicentennial, is a little noticed tip of this iceberg, reported in the Wall Street Journal for November 14, 1975. Within the prison that America is scheduled to become, if you choose not to act and lose your gamble, life will not be worth living just a few short years from now. If you have the misfortune to be a small businessman, you will watch as the unique, special business you have built up with blood, sweat, and pride is unceremoniously stuffed out before your own eyes under the corporate socialism of the new Rockefeller Constitution. Suddenly it will be all too bitterly apparent to you that the several nationwide organizations and federations of businessmen have completely betrayed their memberships, knowingly or otherwise, by frittering away their resources, haggling over this bill and that regulation, while studiously ignoring the real threat. Even as I say these words, the names of millions of individuals all over America are in computerized files ready for any use. In fact, the odds are better than 1 in 4 that you will even get to take an involuntary trip during resettlement from your present home to one of the 121 development centers recommended recently by the Commission on Population and the American Future, headed by, guess who, John D. Rockefeller III. His report recommended that 64 million Americans be uprooted and moved to these centers, wiping out thousands of small towns so that the huge agribusinesses controlled by the Rockefellers can exploit the whole countryside. Over a year ago, legislation to facilitate such wholesale resettling was introduced by one of the Rockefellers' more pliable lackeys, Senator Mondale. America is to be turned into a factory for the ally of the Rockefellers, the Soviet Union. For 20 years, Japan has served as our factory under the exploitation of John D. Rockefeller III, and the resulting air and water contamination in Japan are the worst in the world, extending even to widespread fatalities, birth defects, and major health problems. But Japan offers only a weak shadow of the things to come in America, as we are turned into the Soviet Union's captive factory. Our beautiful country is doomed to become a wasteland of nuclear pollution if the insane nuclear power program of the Rockefeller brothers is not stopped. Declining overall health of our entire population is guaranteed under these plans of the Rockefellers. If the rigid population control plans espoused by the Rockefeller brothers permit you to have children a few years from now, there will be a steadily rising risk of their having birth defects due to the effects of low-level nuclear pollution. I am informed that this is already a very noticeable problem in, for example, Las Vegas, Nevada. There, underground nuclear blasts sometimes shake the city and do extensive damage, which is quickly and quietly repaired by the federal government with the ever-present assurance that no radiation leaks have occurred. But if you are allowed to have children under the Rockefeller dictatorship, and if they are healthy at birth, you can look forward to seeing them wrenched from your loving arms to be cared for by the state according to Rockefeller rules. Your children will then be protected from any religious or other beliefs that you might otherwise instill in them that might conflict with governmental desire. Yes, my friends, this is the risk you run if you decide to take the gamble of not acting. If we fail to save America, we will all suffer and suffer horribly. But there is another choice. You can decide to do your part, whatever that may be, even if it may seem small, to try to ensure that justice and truth prevail. If this is your decision, I salute you. There is a price to be paid, but the rewards can be great. Start by realizing that there are no free rides as a patriot. The only free rides are those on the road to dictatorship and disaster. You'll have to pay in time, effort, frustration, and sometimes in money for the privilege of doing what you believe to be right. I warn you now that many of those around you will not be able to open their eyes, not yet that is, and understand what you are doing and talking about. This may be true even of some who are very close to you. This is why you must get your beliefs and convictions straight in your own mind so that you will have the courage of your convictions and not be buffeted around like a leaf in the wind. The rest of this message has to do with some starting points and suggestions for taking action. The plan of action I'm going to lay before you is, in my opinion, absolutely unstoppable if each of us will do our part, trusting that others are also doing theirs. This plan is based 100% on you as an individual, your power under the Constitution, your imagination, your dedication, and your good sense. It is so powerful that it can completely cancel the mass media and other advantages of those who seek to enslave us. Yet the Rockefeller brothers would never attempt to use this technique themselves, and for two reasons. First, it has to be based on truth, not clever public relations lies. And second, it cannot be controlled or manipulated by anyone. Not the Rockefeller brothers, not me, not anyone. My friends, it's up to you. If you, as an individual, would do your part, then we, the people, are about to take back our control of the government that is rightfully ours. And the modern outlaws who are stealing our government will soon see the handwriting on the wall as this slumbering giant that is America comes to life to snap the bonds they are forging. If you remember nothing else, my friends, and I want this to ring in your ears. If you fail, we all fail. And if you succeed, we all succeed. Part 3, Operation Woodshed, a plan of action. My friends, we are truly faced once again with the very thing that led to the American Revolution 200 years ago, taxation without representation. And I'm convinced the key objective toward which we must all work is to reestablish true representation of our best interests, not special interests, in government. And we must do it quickly. We must take our elected representatives, our elected officials, out behind the woodshed, shake them and spank them like the disobedient children that they are, and get them representing us once again. My friends, we must launch Operation Woodshed. I'm about to share with you what I consider to be the key features of a plan of action that can and will do the job. But please do not think that my suggestions in the short talk exhaust the possibilities of what we can do. Use your own imagination. Take stock of your particular resources and opportunities and your own initiative. Do what you can. My suggestions here are the result of a great deal of thought and analysis, but I do not pretend to have all the answers by any means. Indeed, I believe you should beware of anyone who tries, as the Rockefeller brothers do, to make you think that only they know what is best. Instead, I believe every one of us has something to contribute, and that altogether we do have available to us all the answers we need to save our beloved country. I mentioned earlier that the freedom of speech guaranteed to you by our Constitution is a powerful tool that you have, if you will only use it. Now I'm going to prove it. I've always urged in my radio talk shows, in lectures, and in my tapes that you pass the word to others about what is going on. After all, to solve a problem, we must first know what the problem is. That is why I have spent so much effort, as I hope to continue doing, in trying to tell people what is going on. But when I have urged you to pass the word, perhaps you have been inclined to say to yourself, I'd like to do something, but I only know two or three people who would be interested in all of this. My friend, do you have any idea how powerful that makes you? Suppose you succeed in alerting two people, just two people, to what is going on, and you inform them sufficiently that they in turn can pass it on to others. Suppose each of them passes it on to two others, and each of them pass it on to two more, and so on. Once you have started this chain reaction, the number of people who will be informed after the 10th round of repetition will be over 4,000. If you are able to alert and inform three people, and each of them does the same for three more, and so on, the process is even more dramatic. The 10th round of passing the word, after you start the process, will leave over 250,000 people informed, all because you, one individual, had the courage to open your mouth about what you know. My friends, these figures may sound incredible if you are not a mathematician, but they are true. This is the nature of a chain reaction, and the more people each person tells, the faster the chain reaction goes. We are working here with the same principle that makes an atomic bomb so awesome. One atom splits, causes two more to split, which causes four more to split, and so on, until the whole thing runs away into one gigantic explosion. Each person in the chain must be given enough information so that he or she is able to then pass it on to others, and must realize how important it is to do so. If the chain is broken, thousands of people may never learn the truth. So please, expose what you know to everyone you can, but don't try to force it down anyone's throat. Many will not be interested, not yet that is, until they begin to suffer, and you should not waste your time trying to make them listen. There will also be some who will show some interest, but will not quickly rise to the challenge we face. Just tell them what you can. Let them hear any tapes they may find of interest, and then move on while they turn these things over in their own minds. You will have planted some seeds that may bear fruit later, but not immediately. The people you are really looking for are those around you who already realize something is wrong, but may not know what it is. As I can assure you from the thousands of letters I receive, there are more people like this around than you realize. And they are the ones who, once they are told what is going on, will have what it takes to take part in the chain reaction of passing the word. You may be very surprised to discover who these people are also. Often they are not the people you may have heard say much about such things, but are instead quietly simmering with hidden concern. In them you will discover kindred souls you never suspected, if you will only speak. I urge you, each one of you, to launch your campaign to start a chain reaction
of spreading awareness without delay. Time is our biggest enemy. If you tell two people, and each of them tells two, and so on, and if it takes 1 week for it to be repeated each time, it will take nearly 3 months for your chain to pass the mark of 4,000 informed persons. Imagine, 4,000 informed persons. On the other hand, if you can tell three people, and each of them tells three people, and so on, over a quarter of a million people will be alerted in 3 months' time. So don't waste time, and do tell as many people as you can who will really listen and act about what you have to say. Our secret weapon, so to speak, is to get these chain reactions of awareness ignited nationwide, starting with each one of you. Keep in mind that with these chains, we will also be establishing a word-of-mouth communication network to pass on the latest developments throughout the country, regardless of their suppression by the mass media controlled by the Rockefellers. After we reach a certain point, which can occur within a few short months, if we all faithfully do our part, we the people can have our own independent avenues of communication nationwide. After that, we need no longer be at the mercy of the carefully slanted and incomplete news served up by the Rockefeller dynasty's kept press and electronic media. The chain reactions of awareness are the essential first step in our effort to defend our republic against its attackers. This is also the one thing that each and every one of us can and must do. Do it your own way, but please do it. Pass the word to at least two other people, who will in turn pass it on to others as I have described. With these chain reactions of awareness underway, we can move on to the next step, which will gain in power as our nation is progressively awakened to our common peril. If you are a member of any club, fraternal order, labor union, business association, or any other group that brings you in contact with others, you may be able to get the members of that group aware of the peril that faces us all and interested in doing something about it. Don't ignore independent radio stations either. They can play my tapes. Be sure that this is passed on down through your chain to others, too, in case they have access to such groups. And in the case of organizations whose avowed purposes should include activity in this area, find out why the national organization, if there is one, is not doing anything. See if the national headquarters of your club or association can be motivated to do something through prodding from your local chapter. For example, see if they will actively oppose the new Rockefeller Constitution once it is brought to their attention. You may well find that your local chapter of a national organization is ignored and powerless at the national level, that ideas for projects are only supposed to flow down and not up. If so, this is a dead giveaway that the national headquarters, no matter how suave and courteous, has no intention of paying attention to your best interests. Remember, centralized control is a hallmark of the Rockefeller Empire. At this point, the members of your local chapter would be well advised to strike out independently. Do what you as a group believe to be right and necessary, even if this means severing your ties with the national group. Another thing I would suggest is that you establish some means of monitoring for yourself what is really happening in Congress. In particular, Find out what your congressmen and your senators are really doing. Judge their performance, not by appearance and their self-serving words, but by their actions. They do lie, you know. What things are they voting for and against? Do they ever speak up to require a roll call vote on major issues? Or do they go along with the crowd on anonymous voice votes that can't be traced? Don't be misled or fooled by cosmetic public relations gimmicks that in no way meet the real needs of responsive government, such as bringing constituents to Washington for well-publicized visits. Monitoring Congress will probably be most feasible if you can pool your efforts with those of a friend or two. In any case, one thing you can do in this regard is to subscribe to the Congressional Record. Many Americans, if they have so much as ever heard of the Congressional Record, have no clear idea what it is. And the number of Americans who actually read it is very small indeed. Yet the Congressional Record is the official publication, printed daily, through which the transactions of Congress are made public. Every day's debates are published a day or two later, and there is a section in the back where individual senators and congressmen can elaborate on their alleged positions. Very little of what appears in the Congressional Record ever makes it into your newspaper, much less network radio or TV news. But if you will read it, you will soon begin to shudder as you start finding out what is really going on. And you will start finding out just what your congressmen and senators are or are not doing. To find out how to subscribe to the Congressional Record, write to the Superintendent of Documents, Government Printing Office, Washington, D.C. Or if there is a regional office of the GPO near you, you might call them about it. Another suggestion, don't ignore your local and state politicians. They are more accessible to you, and you may be able, especially if you live in a small town, to alert them as one avenue toward uniting your entire community against the menace we face. In doing this, you may also be able to spot potential true leaders who would make good replacements for the non-representatives currently betraying us all here in Washington. As you go along, you will be gradually educating yourself to the true realities of how to get things done. As you begin to coordinate what you are doing with concerned fellow citizens, you will learn many things by trial and error. The power to do comes with the doing, and once you get your feet wet, you will find this is true. The master stroke toward which you and your friends should work, in my opinion, is to place your congressman under the threat of recall. That is, point him out of his soft job that costs you $1 million a year to support before his term runs out, and replacing him with someone who will represent your community. To this end, find out as soon as possible what the laws governing recall in your state and work in that direction. Typically, petitions are involved, and by the time you have put together a citizens group to spearhead the recall campaign against your congressman, the awareness chain reactions I discussed earlier should be bearing fruit. This should enable you to get the petitions you may need as part of the recall campaign. One of the interesting things, by the way, is that if each of you hearing this message gets to work right away, not frantically, not in a panic, but with dedication and determination, and if you work toward the recall objective as it becomes feasible, the entire United States House of Representatives will be in for an electrifying shock at some time in the next several months. If each of you will do these things independently but faithfully, stop and realize what is destined to happen. For a matter of several months, you will each be laying the groundwork, getting your chain reactions going to wake people up, informing yourselves about what your elected officials' real actions are, learning what the procedures of recall are, and organizing to use them. Keep in mind that each of you will be doing these things independently, doing what you decide you should do, your way, based on your own convictions. And yet, there will be a tendency for all these recall drives all over the nation to come to maturity at about the same time. Suddenly, therefore, and with very little warning, smug congressmen, great and small alike, throughout the United States House of Representatives will be served notice by angry voters in their districts back home that they are in deep, deep trouble. This avalanche of recall actions will, quite frankly, be extremely frightening to those men and women in the House of Representatives who have been playing games and going along with the Rockefellers, believing that we would never catch them at it. The Senate, too, will see the handwriting on the wall because the citizens' groups demanding recall of their congressmen can easily band together to demand recall of senators, too. Those congressmen and senators who do deserve to be threatened with immediate recall, and that means most of them, can be required to come home and show cause why they should not be kicked out. Then they can either be sent back to Washington with this sword over their head, knowing that they had better start doing their constituents' will, or they can be ousted and replaced with someone from your own community who will represent you for once. On the other hand, should you find that your district is represented by a rare man or woman who is trying to do what is right, you will have put together a potent force to back them up and to encourage them not to weaken and depart from the straight and narrow under your watchful eye. The effect of all this on the Rockefeller brothers and their henchmen, who are the real enemies, through no fault of our own, will also be devastating. Because, you see, they will be convinced that some centralized, extremely powerful national group has done this. When they discover instead that what has happened has truly developed independently all over the country, they will be completely stymied and justly frightened beyond imagination. They will see that for once there is no single central source they can turn off to stop all this. Instead, they will discover that they are truly confronting the popular desires, awareness, and determination of an entire people, the greatest people on earth, the people of the United States of America. Part 4, The Rebirth of Our Free Republic. My friends, I am firmly convinced that the strategy I have outlined can and will work, especially as it is refined and improved in practice by you as you go along. As I said before, I don't pretend to have all the answers. And there may also be some other strategy that would work. But you have asked me, what can I do? And this is my answer. My faith is in you as an individual and in our Constitution. You are a unique, important, irreplaceable individual. And for that reason, my answer has to be what I have said. And what I have discussed so far is a specific strategy by which we the people can regain control of the government that belongs to us before it is too late. Assuming that each of us will faithfully do his or her part to accomplish this, there are two phases to the task that lies before us. The first phase is to halt our headlong plunge toward dictatorship and to stop the disastrous actions that are being taken by the Rockefeller brothers and their lackeys. But it is not enough merely to remove that which is evil and destructive. The vacuum that it leaves must be filled with that which is good and constructive. The second phase, therefore, will be to replace the terrible legacy of the Rockefeller brothers with the blessings of freedom that our forefathers intended, and to begin the rebuilding of our true republic. During the first phase, I believe we must blow the lid off the twin scandal that centers around the United States Bullion Depository at Fort Knox, Kentucky. Part of this scandal concerns the theft of America's gold supply and the associated monetary manipulations that are causing economic chaos worldwide. The other, even more serious half of the scandal is that of the insane nuclear superpoison processed from plutonium-239. From its place of storage in the central core vault of the United States Bullion Depository at Fort Knox, where America's gold used to be, this horrendous poison is leaking out. As I say these words, in mid-December 1975, it is fanning out over the entire southeast of the United States and into part of the Gulf of Mexico, endangering the health and lives of over 36 million Americans. Exposure of the truth in this unprecedented twin super scandal will lead straight into the corruption and treachery in the top echelons of the Congress, the Treasury, the Justice Department, the General Accounting Office, the Federal Reserve System, the CIA, and other intelligence agencies, including the White House itself, fruits of the manipulations of the four Rockefeller brothers and their allies. Also, we should do all we can to block the plans of the Rockefeller brothers to, in effect, shut down America artificially, to kill it prematurely. They are preparing to create havoc in transportation, curtail critical energy supplies, withhold food and other precious commodities from the marketplace. But why should we follow their orders, if those orders add up to telling us to commit suicide? No man has the right to do that. And the day may soon come when strikes in reverse, that is, refusing to shut down critical activities, as we may be ordered to do, will be necessary. We must move to reverse the trend toward over-centralization of government, industry, and all other organizations that influence people's actions. Foremost among the centralized devices that must be eradicated outright, not just audited or monitored, is the unconstitutional central banking system controlled by the Rockefellers ever since its creation in 1913. The Federal Reserve System. You may be among the alert, informed Americans who already understand how fundamental the Federal Reserve is to the disastrous situation we now face. I plan to have another message soon that deals specifically with those twin disasters of 1913, the Federal Reserve System, and the federal income tax. We must also eliminate the convenient devices now used by the Rockefellers and their co-conspirators to cloak their holdings in secrecy. There's a great deal that can be done in this area if we the people regain control of our destiny. Interlocking directorates, misuse of tax-free foundations, the use of so-called nominees or street names to hold stock, and the surrender of our national sovereignty to multinational corporations are all among the basic problems that must be addressed squarely, honestly, and courageously. And as the bottom line, we must stop the dictatorial new Rockefeller Constitution. Having accomplished phase one, turning the tide against disaster, we will be able to go on to phase two, building a truly bright tomorrow for ourselves and our beloved children. There is a vast amount of creative, worthwhile work to be done in this country. And if we can at last turn our energies to those things, instead of spending our lives on the wasted effort we all endure, thanks to the Rockefeller machine, then there will be work enough and rich rewards for us all. The day can come again when a person can set up shop and produce a unique, new, better mousetrap that will benefit everyone based on his ability to build mousetraps, not his ability to spend half of his time filling out reams of paperwork to the satisfaction of Rockefeller bureaucrats. The day of the individual can dawn once again in America, and our bicentennial can, after all, turn into a joyous celebration as we embark on another 200 years as the world's greatest free republic. Thank you, my friends. Godspeed in the task you have before you, and may we all share in the blessings that our Creator meant for us all. May God bless each and every one of you.